strike. Aaron waiting. The outfield deep and straight away. Back to the high drive. And goes back to the
fence. He is set. They are very deep. They play in the ball. Traxel winds and fires. Big Mac. Swing and a shot into the corner. It might make it. There it is. 62.
High fly ball into right field. She is gone.
In the air to left. Down the line. This ball ends it.
So the tying run is at second. The run that would win the World Series is at first, and Joe Carter is the batter. Now the 2-2. Well hit down the left line. Way back and
gone. To Edgar Martinez down. A fastball swung on, hit to deep center field. Bernie Williams goes back, and it is. Get out the run, Brett, and the buster this time, Grandma. It is a grand salami.
And the 3-2.
Yeah, all right. Good morning, Momentum. I hope that woke you up. Good morning, guys. Hey, my name is Ray. I want to shout out first. I want to say what's up, Navarre and Blackwater. Let's give it up for them. And then go ahead and give it up for you. And then whoever didn't make it, I don't know why they didn't make it, but let's give it up for the people online today, too. Only if you're like in Germany or something should you not make it into the house. But guys, good morning. I wanted to start with a question this morning, and it was, first off, let's preface it. Who loves their family? Hopefully, just raise your hand. All right. Yeah, good. Okay, good. All right. Good, because you'd look like a bad person. All right. And so secondly, though, let's be real. Who has a crazy family? Like, you know other people's families, and you're like gauging off of normal, like, they're crazy. Keep your hands in the air real quick. Okay, most of us. I don't know what that says. But, all right, who has crazy kids? Yeah, crazy wife. Don't do it. Just kidding. Crazy. Don't do that. Look, I just wanted to give you a glimpse real quick of, like, just a few seconds of what it looks like to be in the Millsap house. Okay, so check this out.
Yeah. Why?
I pulled it in my face.
He punched you in the face?
Yes.
Why?
And I pulled in my head.
And you pulled your head. What did you do?
My head.
Okay, but what did Lily do? Did you hit Evan?
Yes.
Why?
And I hit Evan's cheek.
Okay, here's what's going to happen. You need to tell him you're sorry.
Sorry, Evan.
Evan, you tell Lily you're sorry.
Nothing.
Okay, tell her you're sorry you did nothing. Okay, now I want you to hold hands all the way home. Hold hands.
My hand, Evan.
Don't be sad.
I don't know if that's great parenting technique, but it's certainly entertaining for us, so we continue to do it. So check it out. That little girl, that was Evan. That's my redhead. We have a 15 months, I think-ish, Clay. And then we have right there, that was Lily. And then we have Joy. She's 3 months. And so Lily, the really cool thing about Lily, you saw Lily, she's the hold my hand, Evan. Okay, that's her. That's not just like you're getting an, it's just every time. It's like, I want breakfast. I want, you know what I mean? And so that's Lily. And I love Lily. And the cool part about Lily is that she's, I get to call her my daughter, and she gets to call me daddy. And the cool part about that is this, is the fact that me and Vanessa are foster parents. And so we had Lily for 2 years, and it was ups and downs, and we didn't know necessarily, like, are we keeping Lily, or is she going back with her mom, or what does that look like? And so for 2 years, we just loved this girl with everything we had. Technically, Lily is our first child we've ever had. And so she had that part of our heart where we just committed as parents, where God kind of made me a daddy for the first time. And so the cool thing about this story is that Lily, what God did really is, or not really, it is, what God did is he did this huge redemptive story, bigger than I would have ever thought, bigger than we could have ever, like, thought up when we decided that we were going to be foster parents. And so what happened was about 2 years in, during the 2 years, God grabbed the heart of Lily's mom and turned her around, changed her life completely. And she is completely changed. She got baptized, and she's actually part of our Momentum family. She's a Navarre. And, yeah. And so it's just like this thing we weren't expecting, but oftentimes, like with God, that's how it works, isn't it? And so here we are, and I'm loving Lily, and I'm giving everything I have as a dad, and not perfect, but she has my heart. And then it was cool because what happened was Lily's mom, she was like, well, I want to dedicate Lily, and I want you guys to be up there, like, with us. Like, you're her dad, you're her other mom, like, come on. And so we went to this, well, first off, like, we gave Lily back. We had dinner together, and we were like, this is our new family. And this is, like, it's crazy. We're little nuts, right? But this is it. This is our family. And then so, you know, that was the last day that Lily lived in our house. And not too long after, about a little over a week later, we were going to have this child dedication. And so here at Momentum, you got to go through a child dedication class just to know what it's all about. And so what we want to do is make that transition smooth and not confusing. And so we hadn't really talked to Lily or seen Lily in those couple days in between. And it doesn't seem like much, but if you're a parent, you know that feeling of disconnect. You know that feeling like if you ever left town on vacation or whatever, and you're like, oh, I just miss my kids. And so for me, it was just like, man, we just miss Lily. And we know it's an amazing story what God is unfolding here. But I miss her, and I hadn't got to hold her. I hadn't got to tuck her in. You know, we had our bed, and she's not in the bed. And there's just a couple elements that we, you know, you don't know how to prepare for. And so we knew that we were going to see her at this dedication class, and we got there a little bit early. And all I remember is I'm at a table, and I'm trying to kind of help a little bit. And I hear, Daddy. And that if you're a dad, if you're maybe it may be a mom too, but if you're that daddy, like when you're actually a daddy, that feeling that kind of goes, oh man. And so it hit me, and I knew who it was. And I turn around, and it's Lily, and she's that small. We're praying for her. But she and I look at her, and I'm like, oh, Lily. And so I pick her up, and she just hugs onto my neck. And she gives me a little smooch on the neck, and then we give a little smooch. And she just arms around me, and she looks right in my eyes. She goes, I love you. And she doesn't do it, like, sassy. She does it like I was like, I think you mean it. And she goes, I love you. And I said, I love you. And I'm just looking at her. And then what happened next, I did not know was going to happen. She goes, Daddy, I miss you. And I wanted this, you know, what came out of my mouth was, yeah, I miss you too. But I did not know what God was about to do in that moment. Because when she said, I miss you, my breath was taken away. And what I felt in my heart was, Ray, you missed it. And it wasn't this feeling of guilt or shame or you're a bad dad or you're a horrible person. It was nothing like that. But I'm looking into the eyes of this beautiful little girl. And she says, I miss you. And these thoughts start coming through my head. I'm like, Ray, really? I'm looking at these eyes and I'm like, was a screen work? Just looking at the screen as many minutes and hours as you do, was it worth more than looking into the eyes of this little girl? Was like the times when it's bedtime and I'm rushing Clay and he's covered in peanut butter and we didn't even have peanut butter, right? And then there's Evan and he's redheaded, so he has that going on and he's just running around, right? And then there's Lily and you saw that, right? And then the middle of it, was it worth it, Ray, to rush that process so that you could just have a couple minutes to yourself? Not minutes you didn't have, just extra sleep, extra rest, extra me time. Was it worth it to short her just a few minutes to read her a story? And these thoughts are running into my head. Was it worth all the energy and mental capacity, Ray, seeking approval, pursuing approval from people? And when you got home and that's what was on your mind, was that worth it? Was it worth stealing from her, a person, a little girl who already not just approves of you but adores you as daddy? And I'm holding my baby. And everything inside of me is screaming, nothing, no thing can this world give me that is worth more than this baby girl. And then in that moment, God did not let shame overcome me. He did not let guilt come over me, but he did let conviction slip in. And God shined a light in a place that I had not examined in a long time. My wife, my kids, my friends, my family, the people that I love, that I work with. What God showed me that day was that I had major lack of priority for these people that mattered the most. I had been pursuing things surrounded around myself, and I had missed it. And my message, our message today is don't miss it. Don't miss it. And what is it? It is really this question that we got to ask ourselves. Because if we want to change, we kind of have to ask questions to get real answers. We can't just say, I'm going to do it. We have to go deep. And what is it? When I said don't miss it, what I'm saying is, are people a priority in our lives, in your life and in my life? Are people a priority, or do they come second to something more self-serving? Are the people in your life a priority, or do they come second to something more self-serving? And this is important. Why is it important? Because God, this love letter from God, the Bible, it has plenty of commands, but Jesus makes it simple for us. And he says, if you just do this one, it actually sums up all of them. Matthew 22:37-39. He says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. That's the first, that's the greatest commandment. But the second, here it is equally as important. Love your neighbor as yourself. Why is prioritizing people of value, of worth? Why do we need to do it? Because God says to prioritize him first and then prioritize people. Love God first and then love his people. Enter into a loving relationship with the God Almighty and then reciprocate that love to people. And so there are these things that will steal the priority of people in our lives. They will steal the position of people in our hearts. And if it happens, we miss it. It's not just some command. It's the design that God has called us to walk in, to love him and to love people. Prioritize him first. Prioritize people. And so what I want to make us aware of today are these areas, these kind of umbrellas, areas of our life that can steal the priority of people away from our hearts. And I don't think that most of us, to be honest, if you're like me, it's not like I intentionally go around and prioritize people second. But if we don't intentionally prioritize people over those things, something will take their spot. And so what I want to make us aware of, this isn't everything. This isn't all the things. But there are these three huge areas in our lives that can steal the position of priority, steal the position of people in our hearts, steal the priority of people in our hearts. And I don't want us to miss it. And so there's these three things. Number one is our pleasure, my pleasure, personal pleasure. Number two is my progress. And number three is my program. See, my pleasure is my comfort zone. My pleasure is my comfort zone. It's my it's the me-centered choices that I make in my life. It's my wants over your needs. My progress is anything from promotion to position to profit to advancement. It's advancing myself, getting power. And I got to be honest, we want to be up upfront about this. These things alone, some of these things alone aren't bad. Profit, promotion, those are good things. That means you're a hard worker. But when we prioritize these things over people, we miss it. And then you got my program, and my program is kind of subtle because it's your agenda. It's the my way or the highway kind of thing that hides in some of us. And this can be small. It can be like, this is what the weekend needs to look like, and if it doesn't, you're going to feel me. Okay? Or it can be bigger, and it's more spread out over time. Maybe it's your agenda in your marriage. Maybe it's your agenda in your relationships. Maybe it's at work. And it's okay, it's human, to have an agenda. But when you prioritize it over people, we miss it. And your agenda, by the way, if you prioritize God first, God will prioritize your agenda to be people. And so these are three areas of our lives, three things in our lives that can steal the position that people have in our hearts and steal the priority that we should give people. And so what I want to do today is I want to learn from experience, evaluated experience. It's something Pastor Tim has talked about in the past. We learn, right, when we evaluate our experiences, but even a deeper wisdom is when we decide to learn from other people's experience so that we don't have to experience some of the things that they had to. And so today, I don't want to just learn from any person out there. If I'm going to evaluate someone, if I'm going to learn from experience, I want to learn from what the Bible identifies as the wisest man to walk the earth. And that's Solomon. Second only to Jesus in wisdom from what we see is Solomon. Solomon went and he wrote Proverbs. Proverbs is just these little sentences, little bits of wisdom. There's 31 chapters of Proverbs. A chapter a day keeps stupid away. I would read it, okay? He also went and did Song of Songs, okay? And it's like this poetic back and forth between him and his lover. I would read it, okay? So, but then he comes and he has Ecclesiastes. He writes this thing, Ecclesiastes. It's this first-person account of his life, and it's later on in life. It's towards the end of his life. And so God gave Solomon wisdom. He, as a young king, he just became king. He's like, I need help. And he's like, I'll give you wisdom because you asked. You were humble and you asked, I'm going to honor you. Here's wisdom. But it's not young King Solomon. This is old, experienced King Solomon. And so instead of talking about the things that he did, I'm going to let him talk for himself. We're going to pick up in Ecclesiastes 2, 1 through 11. I'm just going to read quick. It's 11 verses. That's not short. You ready? Okay, thanks. There we go. Just make sure you're ready. All right. He said, I said to myself, come on, let's try pleasure. Let's look for the good things in life. I found that this too was meaningless. So I said, laughter is silly. What good does it cheer? What good does it do to seek pleasure? And after much thought, I decided to cheer myself with wine. And while seeking wisdom still, thing in the way, I clutched at foolishness. And in this way, I tried to experience the only happiness that most people will find during their brief life in this world. I also tried to find meaning by building huge homes for myself and by planting beautiful vineyards. I made gardens and parks, filling them with all kinds of fruit trees. I built reservoirs to collect the water to irrigate my flourishing groves. He's not even bashful about it. He's like, yeah, your garden sucks. Like, look at this, flourishing, right? I bought slaves, both men and women, and others were born into my household. I also owned large herds and flocks, more than any of the other kings who had lived before me in Jerusalem. I collected great sums of silver and gold, the treasure of many kings and provinces. I hired wonderful singers. Beyonce was at his house, okay? Men and women, and many beautiful concubines. He had 600 concubines. Concubines are women that he slept with that were his. He owned. He had 300 wives. I think I know where he went wrong. Moving on. So, I had everything a man could desire. So I became greater than all who had lived in Jerusalem before me, and my wisdom never failed me. Anything I wanted, I could take, I would take. I denied myself no pleasure. I even found great pleasure in hard work. I rewarded a reward for all my labors. But here it is. But as I looked at everything I had worked so hard to accomplish, it was all so meaningless. Like chasing the wind, there was nothing really worthwhile anymore. He goes on for 12 chapters. He had pleasure. He had progress. He had his own program going on. And for 12 chapters, he covers everything from wisdom to sex to being wealthy, wealthy beyond anything we understand or ever will. He covers every little thing that the world could possibly give you. And he ends it all, 12 chapters, meaningless, meaningless, meaningless. And you're like, Solomon, everything meaningless? Why? It's not, if you're depressed, don't go and read Ecclesiastes. Okay? I did that once. I was like, that was dumb. Okay? But here's the deal. 12 chapters. He's got everything a person could ever want. More than you could probably literally dream of. He withheld from himself no pleasure. And at the very end of the book, chapter 12, 13, he says this. That's the whole story. That's the whole story. Here now is my final conclusion. Fear the Lord and obey his commands, for that is everyone's duty. It's a weird way to end what seems like a rant. Seems like he's just some angry old guy. But this isn't some worthless rant. This is a wise warning. Why, Solomon, if you had all the pleasure, I withheld no pleasure from myself. Why, you had all the progress, more than any other person before you, more than anyone who would follow. Why, you talk about program, it's not like a my way or the highway, it's a my way or the die way. Like, I'm king, don't cross me. He had everything. Why, Solomon, at the end of your life, were you like, it's meaningless, it's meaningless? Because he turned around and he saw all that he had accomplished and all that he had gained and all that he had experienced, and he recognized that he missed it. And he goes, and he's looking at us and he goes, there's one thing. He's like, that life that you think that you want, the life that you think that is going to fulfill you, like you think that sex is going to fulfill you. I had 600 women at my call. You think your car is cool, that's going to fulfill you? Is it engraved in gold? Because everything I own is. You think money is the issue? Take it. Take all you want. Whatever you think is the problem, whatever you think you can gain worldly is going to fix your issue. He is trying to tell us there's one thing. There is only one thing that is going to fill that gap. And he gives it to us at the end. He says, obey his commands. And Jesus simplifies it. And he goes, let me just give you the greatest one. You need to love people. You need to love God first, 100%. Put him first, but then you need to love people. You need to prioritize God first, 100%. And then you need to prioritize people. And if you're not, you're missing it. And you're not just missing some command. You are literally missing the design that God has made you to live within. To enter into a loving relationship. God is a person. He's not some statue somewhere. He's not some thought or theory. He is a person who wants to have interactions with you. A loving relationship with God first and foremost. And then reciprocate that love to people. And then you are walking in alignment with the design that God has given you. You're not just missing some commandment in some book. You are created with a purpose and with a certain design, and it is to be fit and full of your Creator so that you can pour it out to people. Jesus, the King, the Prince of Peace stepped off of his throne because he prioritized people. The King of Heaven prioritize people. He stepped off. If you don't know this, you are dead in your sin. Unless you have accepted the forgiveness of Jesus Christ and accepted the fact that he has risen 3 days later, defeating our sin, forgiving us of our sin, but also defeating death. If you don't know that, you are a dead man or a dead woman walking, and that's not fun. But that's not the heart of God. He prioritized you. He prioritized me. He prioritized us. He prioritized people. And he stepped off the throne, and he became our imperfections and our failures, our sin. The perfect one became imperfect so that we might know him, might get to become the sons and daughters of God. It's a choice. He doesn't force himself on us. It's a choice, and he did it all because he's madly in love with you. He prioritizes people. And if we think for a second, church, that our pleasure or our progress or our programs are more important than the precious people that Jesus died for, then we are missing it. We are off the mark. Prioritize God. Prioritize people. But how? It's not just an action step. It's not just I'm just going to do it. It starts with a choice. It does. And it starts with prioritizing God, because you're going to need a lot of grace and a lot of patience and a lot of his power to get this done. But how do we become a people who prioritize people? God first. But how? It has to be a life change. It has to be a heart change. It has to be a priority change. So there's three things I want to cover. How do we become a people that prioritize people? Number one, you got to prioritize people. There you go. Done. No, here's the deal. You got to prioritize people over pleasure. We talked about pleasure. Pleasure isn't just like receiving things and feeling good, but pleasure is our comfort zone. And people are worth stepping outside of your comfort zone. God blessed me the other day. We're on a plane. I don't have a great history with being on planes, right? Like, if you weren't anxious on a plane, and I had a great plane ride this time, but, like, most of the time, if you're not an anxious person, you would look at me and then get anxious. You're like, is something wrong? Because that guy is dying right now. I'm gripping the seat. Tears are coming down my face. I'm like, God, I thought you loved me, right? Like, and we're flying in the belly of a dragon at 500, whatever, like, miles per hour. It's insane, okay? But we're on a plane the other day, me and my wife and our family, and this guy starts this conversation. I'm not in my comfort zone. I'm just glad that I'm not freaking out. I'm holding a baby. It's really for her and my family that I'm not just bawling right now out of just like, I hate this, okay? And I'm holding the baby, and he starts this conversation. And in the middle of the conversation, in the middle of my uncomfort zone, if that's a thing, God prompts my heart. There was this thing he said. And God said, he doesn't know me, and he needs to know I love him. You're the guy. You're up. God, I'm in a plane. I know you're here and there, but do you know what a plane is? It's a tuna fish can with wings. Like, I'm not in my pleasure zone. I'm not in my comfort zone. But this man's life, his eternal life, his potential relationship with God is much more important and precious to God than how I feel right now. That's the facts. I got feelings, but that's the facts. And so we get in this conversation. I'm holding a baby. I'm in a plane. And we start doing this thing. And God's like, you got to go there. Because he doesn't know me. He has to know the good news. And so I'm like, can I sit next to you? If you're one of the people who don't like being on a plane, you also don't like standing up in a plane. You want the seatbelt on. Crossing over the aisle is like that lava game you played as kids. Only real. Okay, so, and I get over in the seat, and I'm sitting next to him, and we're talking, and God's like, do it. Just so you know, it was 4th of July, and if you were outside, there's a lightning storm going on one side, and bombs going off in the air on the other. I'm not in my comfort zone. But God's like, he is precious to me, Ray. And so thank God I got to the gospel clearly enough to where this man starts crying. I had a picture, but it's weird. It's two guys who have never met holding hands on an airplane. Okay? I didn't know what was happening. She took the sneaky Vanessa took the photo. But he's crying and he accepted Jesus as Lord that day. Guys, we have to prioritize people over our pleasure. We have to prioritize people over our progress. I have volunteers that I love, but sometimes I wonder when they get the phone call from me, do they expect another to-do or do they know that I care? And the day I was holding Lily, and I'm talking about up to this point, I'm still working on this. God was like, they don't know, Ray. Business owners, do the people that work under you and work for you, do they know that you care as a person, not as some product they can produce? We have to prioritize people over our progress. We have to prioritize people over our program. I know what it's like to want a weekend to yourself, to want 10 minutes to yourself, parents. But when your son hasn't seen you for 2 days, my 4-year-old needs to know that he is a priority. How do we become a people who prioritize people? We have to prioritize people over our pleasure, over our progress, and over our program. Number two. How do we become a people that prioritize people? We have to ask ourselves. It's another evaluation question. You got to ask yourself, how do I categorize people? Because the way you categorize people determines on how you prioritize people. What do you mean categorize people? Are they a person or are they a pawn to advance your progress? Are they a person or are they a pest in the middle of your pleasure? Are they a person or are they a problem to your program? The way you categorize people will label them, and the way you categorize people will determine on how you prioritize people, and you got to watch your mouth. You're talking about the sons and daughters of God. Even if they don't belong to Jesus yet, you're talking about a creation of God made in his image like no other. You got to watch how you categorize people. How do we become a people that prioritize people? You got to prioritize people. You got to watch how you categorize people. And then there's this other question that we have to ask ourselves. This is a question that Pastor Tim asked me. And I've tried to ask some people, and it is hard. This is one of the hardest questions you can actually ask somebody. And I suggest that you get with God first, and you just get real with God, because he's gonna take most of the blow away if it's just between you and him, and you take the time, and you get humble before God, and you ask this question, God, what is it like to be on the other side of me? What does it feel like to be on the other side of me? And then take that question with God and take it to your family. I suggest one-on-one because you will feel beat up afterwards. And when you ask the question, shut up. Close your mouth and open your ears. Because you will not grow if you are constantly defending pride. If you don't ask the question, if you don't want to hear the answer, ask your wife, what is it like to be on the other side of me? Go to one of your best friends and say, I need you to be real. You're my best friend. I need you to be real, real with me. What is it like to be on the other side of me? Go to one of your friends. You know, me and Tyler did this. Tyler Navarre, campus leader. We kind of check in on this, I'd say, consistently. And we go through a couple questions, but really what we're unpacking is, what is it like to be on the other side of me? And then when you ask, shut your mouth and open your ears. And then take that and bring it back to God. And say, I need some help. We need, if we're going to be a people who prioritize people, we got to prioritize them over our pleasure. We got to prioritize them over our progress and our program. We got to learn how to see people and categorize people the way that God sees and categorizes people. And we got to be humble enough to get in front of some people, to get in front of God, and just ask the question. The world needs a people who will prioritize God. America needs a people who are going to prioritize God. The world needs people who will prioritize people. Your family, your wife and your kids, your husband, your grandma, your grandpa, your family, that cousin you haven't talked to in a while, your friends, and the people that God has purposely surrounded you with need you to prioritize them as a person. They need to know that they are not a pest. They need to know that they're not a pawn. They need to know that they're not just another problem to somebody. They need to know that in the eyes of God and your eyes too, that they are absolutely precious. Don't miss it. It's not just a command. Your life, you as an individual, were designed to walk in line with this command. Love God with everything you are and have. And then take that love and give it to people. Prioritize God first. And then prioritize people. It's the most important thing you can do. You can have $1 million in the bank at your funeral, or you can have 1 million people. Which legacy do you want? Don't miss it. Let's pray. I know that there are people in this room that you didn't intentionally prioritize people second. But I know that there are people in this room that you are currently putting people second to something more self-serving. And so if that's you in here and you're making a commitment and you're saying, your heart, you're like, I want a heart change. I want to take the step. I want to take a next step of prioritizing people. I want to prioritize God, but I want to prioritize people. I want to become part of the people that prioritize people. If that's you, then I want to pray over you. I want to pray over me, and I'm part of this group. I am working on it currently. And so if that is you, I want to ask you for boldness and humility. Everybody's eyes are closed, but stand up. If you're walking through life right now out of line of God's design and you're prioritizing people second to our other priorities, then stand up if you want to change that. In Navarre and in Blackwater. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you in the name of Jesus, the life-changing, life-saving name of Jesus. And I pray, Lord, that we would submit ourselves, God, to your leadership and your authority in this area of our lives. That you would change our hearts, God. You would tender our hearts. That you would align our path, God, with what you have designed us in the way that you have designed us to be. that we would learn to know you and love you, but we would turn around and understand that the world, with the exception of one person, us, is made of others. We need to prioritize people. God, I pray that our hearts would change to our wives and to our husbands. God, I pray that we would look at pleasure and progress and program and understand they are a part of life, but they are nowhere worth putting over the people that you have given us. I pray that we would look at our kids and understand the worth, the gift that you have given us in these babies. I pray, God, that we would see people that we work with in a different light. Everybody's going through something. Let us be a people that prioritize people. Let us be different, God. I pray when we walk in the room, God, that people would know that we are about people, that people would know that we care about them before we care about what they can do or care about them getting in the way, God, that we would, the way we would live would communicate, you are not a pest and you are not a pawn and you're no problem to me, but I see you as precious. I see you as worth it. God, I pray you do a deep, deep, life-changing work for every person who was willing to stand in humility in front of you, God. I pray this in the name of Jesus. It's in the name of Jesus we trust that this will happen. Amen. You can sit. And I want our eyes closed, heads bowed still. And I want to talk to people in the room who you haven't made that decision. You have not given your life over to Christ. And I just want to highlight what we've already talked about today, which is the fact that God is not mad at you. That's a lie. He is madly in love with you. That he was willing to become our imperfections. Nobody in here is perfect, but God, Jesus, was perfect, yet he left the throne. Sin, the payment for the failures and imperfections in our life is death. It's an eternal death. It's an eternal separation from God in a place called hell. That's some bad news. It's a place completely void of God's love. But there's some good news in that Jesus came down and he paid the price for our sin. He died the death that we deserved, and by doing so, he forgave us of our sins. He forgave us of those failures. He forgave us of our imperfections. But then 3 days later, he rose again, not just showing that he can just defeat and forgive us of sin, but he defeated death itself so that we can live life here, now, to the fullest with him, but that we also have an eternal forever life with him in paradise. And he's a good father. And what he's calling you to do, what he asks of us, is that we would just put our trust in Jesus, that he has forgiven us of our sins, and that we would make him Lord, meaning we don't just accept the love of leadership or the love of Jesus, but we also accept the leadership over our lives and giving him authority. And it doesn't come without life change. But if you want to accept the forgiveness and the love and the leadership of God, you want to give your life to Jesus, trusting in what he did for us and what he did for you and not what we can do for ourselves, then I want you to pray with me. Not to me, not through me, but just pray with me. I want to help you take your first step in a relationship, an eternal forever relationship with God. And church, we're going to pray it together to help those who are praying this for the first time. And it is this. It is, Jesus, today I accept your forgiveness. I accept your love. I accept what you say about me. I accept your leadership in my life. I'm giving you my life. You are my Lord. Thank you for saving me. Teach me how to love and teach me how to live. It's in your name, Jesus, that I put my trust. In your name. Amen. Looking up here. church, if that was you today, if you're in this building, if you're in this building, if you're in Navarre, if you're in Blackwater, even if you're online, if you gave your life to Christ today, what that means is you are adopted into the royal, holy, eternal family of God. You are a son or a daughter of God. And church, just so you know, I'm about to count to three. And when I count to three, if you made that decision, then I want you to take 3 seconds of boldness. I want you to be bold. I want you to be humble like you just did. And I want you to raise your hand. And don't be surprised, because the people around you are going to lose their minds and they're going to celebrate because you just got adopted into the family of God. And so if that is you, I'm going to count to three. We got a gift for you. Keep your hand up until you do it. One, raising your hand on three. Two, three.